stories of children today. Lots in common, and some stories of clothing. All the readings today will be familiar as stories that we've heard times gone by. But let's look for some of the deeper truths that these stories offer that we can carry into our lives. Luke's community would instantly have seen the way he was looking at the stories of Samuel as he shaped what he was writing about Jesus. A few weeks ago, we saw that Mary's song resembled Hannah's song when they each learned that they were going to become mothers. Each of them saw their pregnancy in a personal light, but also in a larger communal context. Let's look at the older story first. I'm sure many people remember the way Hannah and her husband Elkanah went to the temple every year for the Passover festival. And one year the priest noticed her praying so desperately to have a child that he thought she was drunk. But when he spoke to her and realised what was happening, he reassured her that she would have a son. And she promised that the child would be given to God. So after Samuel was weaned, she took him to the temple and left him with Eli to learn to become a priest and a prophet. And every year, as she and Elkanah continued to travel to the temple for the Passover, she would take a new coat for her son. And he grew in wisdom and in favour as he grew in stature. There's a little nugget to take with us, as we notice that Jesus also grew in wisdom. In other words, he wasn't perfect and knowing everything from the beginning. He had to learn. So there is room for mistakes in his life. Some people don't like that idea. But there's a wonderful story about a conversation with a woman who helped him understand that his message was for the Gentiles as well as for the Jews. In fact, for everyone. Well, in the only story we have between the birth narratives and the beginning of his ministry, Jesus is travelling with his family to the temple in Jerusalem for the Passover, like Samuel did before him. And that it happens as Jesus is going to Jerusalem for the Passover is not to be missed. This becomes a major theme for Luke's Gospel. Much of it is structured around the big final trip up to Jerusalem for the Passover, the trip which culminated in the arrest and execution of Jesus. But here, Jesus is 12, an auspicious number for Israel, and this age places him at the beginning of manhood. Possibly it's time for his bar mitzvah, if they celebrated it in those days. And the context for his parents losing him is that they live and are travelling in community. You can understand how they might have thought he was with another group, maybe relatives or other boys his own age. The family group is much bigger than the nuclear family. This is usually a healthy relationship. I remember being so grateful when my children were small to be part of a church family in a little country town where I knew the teenagers would be looking out for my little ones. And that our lives were intertwined with the lives of other families. Now, and I marvel again at there's a group within this congregation of mothers who started meeting when their children were toddlers. And they've been supporting each other for nearly 60 years. The parent support is one aspect. But for the children, it's good to have people other than parents who are concerned for their healthy growth in wisdom. And here Jesus is finding it with the men in the temple. In today's story, when the young Jesus is mistakenly left behind, his frantic mum and dad leave the group and rush back to Jerusalem to look for him. And Luke tells us it's 3 days before they find him. This is not the last time people will think they have lost Jesus in Jerusalem. And it's not the last time he will reappear 3 days later. It's not the last time that Luke will introduce us to a couple on the road who are distraught at having lost Jesus but who find him again, engaged in the discussion of the scriptures. You'll probably recognise the story near the close of the Gospel, where Luke tells us of the couple on the road to Emmaus. He tells us they had put their hopes on Jesus, but now that he had been lost, and they were devastated. And it's been 3 days now. And then Jesus appears with them, unrecognised at first, and discusses scripture with them, pointing out to them exactly the sorts of connections between the stories that we are noticing now. And finally, they recognise him in the breaking of the bread. Both of these stories, the 12-year-old Jesus lost in Jerusalem and the road to Emmaus account, appear only in Luke's Gospel, with one being near the start and the other close to the end. They serve something like a frame for the rest of the story. Losing Jesus, or being lost ourselves and being found by Jesus, are significant themes in Luke's Gospel. We're beginning the study of Luke for this year. This is the year of Luke. You'll notice that in neither of these stories of Jesus being lost does Jesus himself think he's lost. It's other people who think he is lost, not him. He is about his Father's business. I really like the way these stories link. But now I'm going to do a really big outrageous segue to the link with Hannah taking clothes to Samuel and Paul's instructions in the letter to Colossians to clothe ourselves with certain attributes. We could simply take these attributes as a list of how to behave. Do this, do that in order to be good, which is okay. But it would miss the context from the beginning of the chapter. Something wonderful. It speaks of the people having risen with Christ. Something has happened to them, or have begun to happen in them as they grow in wisdom. These people should understand themselves to be chosen, beloved, and holy. What a great starting point. If only this could sink into their awareness fully, it would generate a whole new set of attitudes and behaviours. They'd leave behind those attitudes that see other people as competitors, to be outdone or manipulated or controlled. When we begin to take seriously that we are chosen, we are holy, we are loved, then we begin to value ourselves and don't need strategies to try and make ourselves special. And we don't have to strive mightily to be better. This kind of change doesn't happen overnight, but it is part of our growing in maturity as people. There's a very positive process at work which will gradually produce good fruit. The more free we become from ourselves and our anxieties and worries about ourselves, the more energy and space we have for other people. But it's not automatic. It needs working on because the grooves run deep. So let me challenge you. You are loved. You are chosen. You are holy. Believe it. Apply it. Let it sink in. This list of attributes to clothe ourselves with is not just another set of commands to be good, but they're encouragement to let things happen, to support the process of living in love and not in fear. As God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Forgive each other, clothe yourselves with love, and let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which you were indeed called in one body. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. In other words, simply allow and affirm growth in generosity openness in ourselves and in others. And then not forgiving one another just doesn't make sense. We're not about holding grudges, but about giving and forgiving. And in verse 14, the author brings it back again to love. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. Love is what produces maturity in the individual and unity in the community. And such love produces a certain kind of peace. It's not about a lack of conflict or a lack of hardship. We know Paul had much of that, certainly his fair share. What makes the individual whole also makes the community whole. And in both cases, people need to work on it so that what is potentially there becomes actuality. Just like, if you look at verse 16, we've got a mini church. Part of the process for keeping part of the way of keeping it going is this being together, teach and admonish one another in all wisdom. And that would mean tradition and stories, the sayings of Jesus, the word of Christ, dwell in you richly. It's a place where love and its fruits are generated. Church must include actually gathering. So there is real communication. And if the individual must live in an expansive, generous way, so the community needs both the teaching based on the word and tradition, and also ways of expression that take us into poetry and music, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. You can't do that on your own so much. Behold the church. And something else I picked up from clothe yourself in these attributes, and it's this idea that you put this stuff on. I know that sometimes we feel like we're just acting when we're being compassionate or forgiving, but underneath we still want to punch out the likes of someone who has hurt us or someone we love, more likely. And I was delighted to see Nathan Nettleton saying, there's nothing wrong with putting it on. It beats the hell out of putting it off. Keep putting it on, and when it slips, put it on again. And one day you will realise you are no longer putting it on. You will have grown to fit it. It will now be you. Day by day, like him we grow, says the carol. I picked up this hat. I was given some clothing for Christmas. Some of you might have been given clothing for Christmas. But if I move, it's going to fall off. If a wind will take it, no. I don't think I'm going to grow into it. I think it's going to go in the garage sale in January. If you know you still have some growing up to do, relax into letting God be God in your life. Instead of beating yourself up for still needing to grow, let the ongoing relationship with God, who is generous and active in love, draw you more into this way of being. That is our work. And our carol that we're going to sing now is Love Came Down at Christmas.